understand that you have been discussing this four Brahma Vihara, four sublime states. So far you have completed first two items, Metta and Karuna, isn't it? So what is the meaning of Metta? Loving kindness. Then there are two things, love and kindness must go together, isn't it? Another meaning, metta. The real meaning of this word is actually goodwill. Metta means goodwill. Because in our love or in our kindness, we can find out some sort of ulterior motive. Some sort of selfishness is behind. If there is no selfishness, we never love. If there is no selfishness, we do not extend our kindness. There is. So when we use the word goodwill, this goodwill is free from selfishness. That is why the Buddha has used this word metta. So you have heard. Then the second one is Karuna. What is the meaning of Karuna? What is the meaning of compassion? What is the difference between kindness and compassion? Is there any difference? Kindness, sympathy, and pity. When we analyze these words very carefully, we can find out there is some sort of emotional satisfaction in our mind. We entertain our own emotion. Now that is the nature of kindness, sympathy, and pity. But the same thing, we can misuse and abuse. Take for instance, a male and female. Now this is one of the advices given by the Buddha. When a man extends his kindness towards a woman, the Buddha says, if that woman is not your wife, you have to deal with that kindness very carefully. Because that kindness may turn into something else later. Now you can understand. Then, these four items just now I mentioned, known as Brahma Vihara. Do you know the meaning of this word Brahma? What does it mean? So why did the Buddha introduce this as Brahma Vihara? We have not heard. Yes, something like that. The real meaning is noble. Noble attitude. Noble states. Higher than all the other worldly virtues and the qualities and characteristics. We we have three characters or three natures in our life. Whether we are good or bad, educated or not, we have, by nature, we have three characters. Animal nature, human nature, and divine nature. But in certain cases, we can see animal nature is submerged or keep under control, and human nature can be seen there. But in certain other cases, human nature is submerged, animal nature can be seen there. Very, very rare cases. Amongst millions, there may be five or one or two who maintain divine nature by controlling animal nature and human nature. Now listen carefully, then you can understand the differences. Why do we maintain animal nature? Now, we can give reasons in two ways. First, let us refer to the scientific discoveries, anthropology, or theory of evolution. So it is already accepted, we are also animals, derived from animals. This is the evolution or the development of animal life into human form. Physically, although there are some changes, four legs reduced into two legs. And when we were animals, we walk in this way. But today, we are walking in this way. These are the differences. And the backbone, when we were animals, was like this. Now our backbone is like this. This is called evolution, development. In our brain cells, neurons, and mental faculties, we can see certain development after these evolutions and the development. Now you can understand why we maintain animal instinct, animal nature, animal behavior. Still we maintain. This is scientific. No one can deny this. Now let us come to the other side. Refer to the Buddha. There are 31 planes of existence. Hell, animal kingdom, a spirit form, ghost or demons. Humans, and then six kinds of deva realms and 16 kind of brahma realms. Then one more, formless brahma realm. Existence or rebirth can take place in one of these places according to our way of thinking, way of talking, and way of doing things. But not according to our belief. Remember this. You can believe anything in this world. Belief is not important here. Because most of our beliefs are imagination. When we analyze, there is no reality in our belief. Due due to lack of understanding, ignorance, stupidity, misunderstanding, we maintain many kind of belief until we realize the truth. When we realize the truth, we drop all these beliefs. This is the nature of belief. But the important things are only these three. The way how we think, the way how we talk by using that mind, and the way how we do certain things by using the same mind. So good and bad are natural, not belong to any particular religion, or not belong to any God, not belong to any Buddhas. They are universal laws. So existence can take place in any of those places according to our way of life, not according to our belief. Everybody believes that he or she can go to heaven. But that belief doesn't work if that person has not prepared the ground by using his or her mind properly. Belief is not important. Some others do not believe that there is a heaven, but their way of life is righteous, noble. Rebirth can take place in so-called heaven, although they do not believe it. So belief is not important. So, we do not know how many times rebirth have taken place as animals during our previous existence. That is how still we maintain certain animal behavior, animal instinct within us. Some of us might have directly come out from animal kingdom. Some others might have come up from hell. Some others came from the demon or ghost world. Nobody knows. So when you analyze very carefully, associate with others, you can see the hidden, natural, intrinsic character. There you can see devilish nature, animal's nature, human nature, and divine nature. When you give a strong drink, liquor, and observe how that person behaves, because at that time that person does not behave as a hypocrite. His natural character can be seen at that time. I think you have seen some people become very violent, very aggressive after taking drink. That means the hidden nature is already aroused and flare up. Another person, after taking drinks, laugh, joke, dance, and become very cheerful because of that drink. That is the natural character of that person. Another person, after taking a strong drink, cannot stand anymore, sleepy, go and sleep, cannot talk also. Here, the natural character. Anyway, I hope you won't try this, you know, to study your brain. It's not a very healthy test. So, When we are normal, we are good, isn't it? Now you are very good. All are cheerful, a smiling face, look very honest, and very kind also. Why? Because others are good. If others are not good, you also never become good. When you are good, I am also good. Because you did not disturb me. That is how we maintain goodness within us. Environments, atmosphere, is very important for us either to be good or to be bad. So any moment, we can change our mind according to the environment. So, at that time we can see the hidden nature that we have been keeping under control. Then animal nature can be seen. So we have to admit that we have animal nature within us. No argument about that. Then, what is human nature? Before religions come into existence, we had humanism. Still there are many people who maintain only humanism but no religion. What is this humanism? However, religion is above humanism. Humanism is just to maintain human dignity and to live as human beings without violating, without disturbing others, by maintaining shame and fear. Now that is humanism. We don't like to do certain immoral or dirty thing because we feel it is shameful. Not because we don't like to do that. We like it, but we feel it's very shame, we shy. Some others are scared to do wicked thing and bad thing. That is called moral shame and moral fear. Shame and fear govern the whole mankind. So we behave as cultured people, civilized people, because of our shame and fear. That is humanism. But religion is above this. What is that? Religion teaches us how to control, how to suppress, how to eradicate the natural animal nature within us. Humanism cannot eradicate, just keep under control. Religion teaches us how to make use of valuable human life, not only to live as human being, but to cultivate, to develop further and further and further. Only religion can do that. Religion teaches us how to make use of human intelligence, how to cultivate this intelligence. We have intelligence, but our intelligence is eclipsed, covered by ignorance and illusions, misunderstanding, and so many other dark clouds. Religion paved the way for us to remove this dark cloud from the mind to see things in proper perspective. But humanism cannot do this. Now you can understand why religion is needed. On the other hand, by upholding religious principles and virtues, we maintain human dignity. We give due credit to our human intelligence. Then we can make use of this human life to do some service to others. And when we serve others, in return, we serve ourselves. Remember, without serving others, we cannot serve ourselves. That is human nature. Now let us come to the divine nature. Here we are talking Brahma Vihara, sublime states. So there is no difference between divine nature, sublime states and Brahma Vihara, same thing. By controlling our animal nature, we cultivated our real human character, human nature. By cultivating our human way of life, human nature, we reach sublime state, divine state, or Brahma Vihara. Many others, means other religionists, introduce this divine nature or sublime states or Brahma Vihara by using some other interpretation. They say, when we believe in God, believe in Brahma, Brahma is the creator God. Through the influence of this God or Brahma, we get the chance to be born or to be with them, to experience immortality, eternal life, final goal in our life. And this is the way how they introduce. But the Buddhism teaches a different method. Without depending on external powers, authorities, influence, agencies, by cultivating your own way of life, by suppressing your own weaknesses, cultivating your own good virtues and good qualities and knowledge, by purifying your mind after eradicating mental defilements or mental weaknesses, you will reach that highest state without any support from external sources. Now this is the Buddhist method. So here this divine nature, Brahma Vihara, sublime state, means highest achievement, development of our human mind. Now then you have completed first two items. How to extend your goodwill and your compassion. To do this, how many evil forces you have to remove from your mind? You have to remove your hatred, your anger, your jealousy, your grudge, ill will, enmity. See, these are the most dangerous, wicked and cruel thoughts in our mind. So when we remove all this rubbish from our mind, then we can extend. Without any discrimination, without any hostility, extend our goodwill to everybody, our kindness and compassion to everybody. But by keeping all those rubbish in your mind, there is nothing for you to extend. You extend more hatred, more jealousy, more enmity. And then there is no sublime or noble estate there in your mind. Now you can understand why we use the word Brahma. The Buddha used this word Brahma in the sense that it is noble, highest. So our item is, what is the subject? Your happiness. Your happiness is? No, your happiness is not my happiness. It's entirely different. I have entirely different kind of happiness. You cannot share my happiness. Now, I like to eat bread. That is my happiness. But you don't like bread, you like to eat mihu. Then how can you say your happiness is my happiness? You like to go to cinema. And to me it is a real torture. How can you say your happiness is my happiness? I like to stay alone in my room, but you like to go and join with others. So your happiness is my happiness, again different. So what does it mean here? The word used by the Buddha is, what is the Pali word? Metta, Karuna, Mudita. This is the word. The word mudita, you have given a new interpretation. Your happiness is my happiness. That's good. Although you cannot share, it's very good. But there is another word. Sympathetic joy. This is the word usually people use in their book, religious language. Sympathetic joy. Because we can enjoy, we can maintain happiness by hurting others, disturbing others, and then there is no sympathy. So if we like to enjoy our life, if we like to gain happiness, we must know how to gain this happiness without disturbing others, not at the cost of others' life. But the real meaning of sympathetic joy is this. There is one thing in our mind that which is very, very difficult for us to control. What is that? Jealousy. For nothing. Without any reason, we develop this jealousy in our mind. That is the idea here. We don't like to see another person who is prospering. We pass remarks. We say something against. Inside there is jealousy. If not, we say, oh, although they are very rich today, we know how their father, what he has done. Dig out some sort of rubbish to condemn. That is our nature. If not, a pretty girl wearing very nice dress and so many jewelries, and another girl staring at this girl for nothing. Look at cannot tolerate that. It is natural. It is natural. And this is the thing that Buddha wanted to point out. Then, in one family, there are 5 or 6 children, brothers and sisters. You can see among those brothers and sisters how they develop their jealousy. They cannot tolerate. One is studying very well, the other one cannot study. That one develops jealousy towards the other, brother or sister. One is very pretty, the other one is ugly. The ugly one hates the pretty one. Amongst brothers and sisters, hear the advice given by the Buddha or the parents. Practical way, how to practice metta, karuna, mudita, upekkha towards their children. Practical way. When a child is born, father and mother take enormous troubles and pains day and night, without sleeping, without relaxing. They keep an eye on and attend to this baby. When the child is sick, mother cannot sleep. He goes crying and worrying and doing everything. So at that stage, mother's feeling toward this baby is metta. The maximum feeling, kindness, compassion, goodwill and everything you can see there. Later, now this child is about 8 or 10 years old. At that stage, the mother develops only karuna, kindness, compassion, but not too much metta. Reduce a lot. Prepare the food and keep there. And go and you put it there, go and eat. But when this child was a baby, by force, open the mouth and push, by force. And now the mother doesn't know how to do that. And everything, in every action, you can see some changes. Kindness is there, compassion is there. But mother or father doesn't want to go up to that maximum level. That is karuna. Now this boy or girl attained teenage, completed education and got married. At that stage, their feeling, their attitude again changed. Now they keep an eye on them. When it is necessary, they go. They find out what they need, whether their services are needed. Otherwise, at that stage, father and mother never go with rotan to train them. That stage is gone. But they like to see their good health, prosperity, development. They share the development of their children, their happiness. Father and mother share without any jealousy. Only father and mother can do that. Brothers and sisters cannot. They develop more jealousy. The more they prosper, the more father and mother feel very happy. They are proud. You see, my son is a doctor now. My son is a lawyer. He is a big tauke now. And the mother That is called sympathetic joy. That is called your happiness is my happiness. Without any discrimination. Now they are adult. They have children. Father and mother occasionally visit them and just find out how they are getting on. That's all. They don't want to interfere with their attitude. Given full freedom for them to take the responsibilities of their life and carry on their life without their interference. That is the last stage, still you did, we have not discussed. That is called mudita, called equanimity. Next item. That means they don't interfere too much and they also never disturb. So if we can maintain this attitude, we can avoid so many problems and troubles and calamities, misunderstanding and enmity. Don't interfere too much with others' activity. At the same time, should not disturb them. When your services are needed, otherwise don't interfere. Go and do something for them. Give them moral support to relieve their suffering. That is the last item. And now let us come back to this, your happiness is my happiness. Why it is difficult for us to share others' happiness? We have three main roots of evil forces in our mind. These three are responsible for all our evil and bad thoughts, words and action. What are those three? Lobha, dosa, moha. And these are the three. In Abhidhamma, the Buddha says, lobho akusala moolam, doso akusala moolam, moho akusala moolam. Moolam means the root, main root, cause. The main cause of all our akusala, bad karma, bad deeds and bad thoughts, is either our craving, or hatred, or ignorance. No any other main cause. Now attainment of sainthood, arahant, means complete eradication of these three roots. In many cases, people cut off these three, but the roots remain. Just like cutting lalang. But after 1 or 2 months you can see how this grass again grows. So what we are doing as our precept or meditation or by performing some meritorious deeds, we cut lobha, dosa, moha without removing the roots. The roots still remain. And later, these roots again start to grow. If not, assume you meditate. During your meditation, you could manage to tame or train your mind. Then you think, okay, now you can maintain this. Or you are advanced in your meditation. But what happened? When you cover an area by using a big vessel where the grass are growing, by using a very big vessel, you close and keep for a few weeks or 1 month. After 1 month or 2 months, you remove this vessel. You can see the grass around this area turn into white color, is it? No more green is color. So the time that you spend during your meditation is exactly like that. You change your mental attitude during that period. But when you come back and deal with worldly things, again turned into greenish color, just like this grass. After 1 week, you can go and see the grass again turned into greenish color. And this is the nature of our mind. So, unless we uproot completely, there is no holiness and there is no guarantee. There is no perfection in our life. So, there are three kinds of craving which create enormous problem in the whole universe, not only in this world. We have craving for our existence. We have craving for pleasure, various kind of pleasure. We have craving for self-destruction. That is called suicide instinct. Three kind of craving. And because of this craving, jealousy appears. And now you can understand why jealousy appears in our mind for nothing. We never gain anything by developing this jealousy. But we develop it. We cannot tolerate. We cannot share the happiness of others. Craving is behind. This craving produces jealousy. This jealousy creates anger. This anger develops hatred. That hatred harbors grudge, enmity. See how these things develop one after the other. Now we are enemies. And what is the cause of this enmity? We can give so many reasons. But the real reason is our craving. If there is no craving, we never develop enmity. Impossible. Because of this enmity, we can attack, we can kill, we can destroy. You can observe what is happening all over the world. In every country, human beings are slaughtering their own brothers. Not animals, or not devils, or not ghosts. They are killing their own brother, human being. What is the cause? Brutality, cruelty, inhuman attitude, they maintain. What is the cause? There is some sort of craving at the beginning. That craving develops into jealousy, jealousy into anger, anger into hatred, hatred into enmity. Enmity starts to fight and attack and kill. We never observe, never analyze, never think in that way. This is the way how Buddha has analyzed, introduced. So if you want to be noble, if you want to maintain peace and happiness and satisfaction in our life, this is the method. Simply by praying, worshipping, offering, burning, we never gain anything. We have to work for this. Because we are the troublemakers. Unless we stop, we means human being, unless we stop all this trouble, how can we accept anything from heaven? Because all these things are not created from heaven. When we cultivate our way of life, by knowing the value of noble life, extending our goodwill, kindness, now sympathetic joy, that means allow others to enjoy their life without disturbing them. Can you do this? If you are not ready to share the happiness that they experience, at least you can keep quiet without disturbing them, without passing remarks, without ridiculing or accusing them. This is the problem. There are some other reasons also. We have so many discriminations. Racial arrogance, color bar, religious discrimination, cultural and traditional differences. These are the main issues that we bring forward to discriminate others, to look down upon others, to condemn others. We never realize this. Our race, naturally, we feel, we support our race, but not others. We like to see the progress of our own race, but not others. That is why we cannot share this happiness. Racial discrimination. These are called worldly conditions. Only religion can eradicate this. Let us take color bar. For nothing, people discriminate or condemn. Here in this world we have white color, yellow color, dark color, brown color, human beings. Why do they maintain different colors? Can you say God created all these colors for people to discriminate? This is the nature. The sun is responsible for that. In that particular country, for their health and for their healthy living, for their survival, that color is important. In certain countries, dark color is important, not white color. But without analyzing this, we discriminate. Oh, they are dark, we don't like them. This is called human weakness. That is why we cannot share happiness. Yes. Here, you hate dark color. You don't like dark color. You say, I like to marry that girl, but she is dark, therefore I don't like to marry. Yes, I heard on many occasions. That means you don't like dark color. Supposing the hair on your head turn into white color, why do you need dark color there? That means dark also important. So you cannot say dark color is bad. We never analyze. Color bar and racial discrimination created by us, then we cannot share our happiness. Then we come to our culture and tradition. In each country, people have their own cultural practices, traditional rites and rituals and ceremonies and way of life. So one group condemns the other group because they have different culture, different tradition. By maintaining, by cherishing any kind of rubbish practices as our culture, we condemn and accuse and ridicule the culture and tradition of others. Remember this. We never realize. We try to justify that our culture, our tradition is the best. Others are wrong. Others also maintain the same attitude. And then the troubles start from there. Discrimination. Then how can we share happiness? Again, the worst thing in this world is religion. Religions have created more troubles, more problems, more headache, more hatred and jealousy in this world. What is the main purpose of religion? The main purpose of religion is to teach us how to live peacefully, without hurting, disturbing, discriminating others. This is the main purpose of every religion. Now when you study the basic principles of Buddhism, Hinduism, Christianity, Islam or any other ism, same basic principle, then why do we discriminate? Through this religion, we or they try to introduce their egoism, not religion. My religion, our religion, but not religion. Our religion. Take simple example. Now I want to give a talk on Buddhism to a public, mixed crowd, where you can see all followers of all these religions. So when they heard that a Buddhist monk is going to give a talk, some Hindus, not all, some Hindus are very, Hindus always sympathize with Buddhists. But there are some fanatics also. Some Hindus and Christians and Muslims, they say, oh, we don't like to hear, that is Buddhism. They walk out. They don't like to hear Buddhism. It is a Buddhist talk. So I go there and advise people, please don't kill, don't steal, don't commit adultery or sexual misconduct, don't tell lies, don't take intoxicating drinks and drugs, don't disturb others. This is Buddhism. The Buddhists say, yes, very good. All the others, yeah, that is Buddhism. Forget about that. Then, a Christian priest want to give a talk on Christianity, announce. A Christian priest will be coming to give a talk. Then the Buddhists, Hindus, Muslims say, ah, that is Christianity. We know what they talk, we don't know. They walk out. Only Christians remain. He goes there and say, thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not tell lies. Only thou shalt is there, but all others are the same. Christianity is thou shalt, that's all. Now what is the difference now? There you can see how we create discrimination. Our own egoism, because my religion, our religion, so we cannot share. By knowing this human weakness, attitude, the Buddha says, this is beautiful advice given by the Buddha. Whenever, wherever you find truth in any religion, accept and respect, irrespective of your religion. Can you find such teaching in other religions? To others, it is a sin. If they come and listen to my preaching, you should not kill, you should not steal, you should not do this, it is a sin. They go to hell because of this. What a pity. What happened to human mind actually? But still people maintain, they believe this kind of thing. They really disgrace their human intelligence. Then how can they share happiness? So, if they introduce religions in this way, to discriminate others, to shun others, not to cooperate and work with others, how can we live together as a community in one country? Forever we go on staring at each other, we never trust each other, then where is happiness, where is harmony? Always in fear. Who created all these things? These narrow-minded religious people. That is why in many countries people throw away all this religion into dustbin. These are religions created so much discrimination. It is not religion. Religions are good. No one can say religion is bad. But those selfish, narrow-minded people who introduced religion created all these differences, discrimination. Today, when four religious groups meet together, it's very difficult for them to harmonize and cooperate and work together. It's just like this, when you collect frogs from here and there and keep all those frogs in one place, ask them to keep without moving. How long can those frogs remain there? One group run this way, another group run this way, another group run this way. So collecting different religious groups, according to my experience, is just like collecting folks and asking them to stay without moving. Because they have their own ideologies, belief and tradition, and one group hate the other group. Whatever we preach, they are not ready to listen because of their strong egoism. So, as long as we maintain these human weaknesses, it is impossible for us to share the happiness of others. So the Buddha's advice is, try as much as possible, without showing your hostility or discrimination to others, let them practice their own religion, their culture, their tradition, without disturbing them. You can practice your religion. You can carry on your noble way of life without disturbing your own mind. That is called noble way of life, sublime state and mudita. So your happiness is my happiness. Thank you.